let's talk a little bit about Comet ISON, okay? Because there are three possibilities that I see with ISON. One, nothing happens, as is usually the case with comets. Nothing happens. Two, it's cataclysmic, from both the destabilization of the sun, causing severe space weather impacting the Earth, and debris, severe amount of dust and debris from its tail and debris field. Or three, is that there is some dust, there is some debris, there is some space weather, but it doesn't turn out to be cataclysmic. However, it does cause a panic in the world. And this panic is used by those who have set everything up for this time to push forward the New World Order and global dictatorship, etc. The New World Cycle. So I think that those are three possibilities. And we just need to be aware that there are those three possibilities. One, it may just be nothing, non-event. Two, catastrophic event with the space weather knocking out satellites, transformers, electrical grid goes down, severe debris field has severe amount of dust, severe amount of space rocks, causes agricultural to fail, the sun gets blotted out, and essentially civilization collapses to a large extent. Or three, there is some dust, there is some acid rain, there is some space debris, a lot of fireballs, there is some space, but it's not catastrophic, and yet what happens is a panic seizes the world. A panic seizes the world, and critical thinking, critical reasoning, all of that disappears, and then it becomes very easy to carry out all sorts of programs for like martial law, that would seem would be unthinkable at this point still. Because I can tell you one thing for sure is that all these plans and blueprints for martial law, global dictators, all that is already in place. The whole structure, blueprint, framework for it is in place. It's like a blueprint for a house. It's all there. The subcontractors have been contacted. They have their insurance. Everybody's ready to go. That is a fact, and many people know that around the world. But the question is, what's going to allow them to proceed? Well, a panic over this comet could certainly allow them to proceed. No question about it. So we have those, three basic options, and we'll review those. Okay, so the first option, we would say all is well. Yeah, much ado about nothing. The Earth is smiley face and no problems at all. The second would be catastrophe, and we have the Earth surrounded, tremendous amount of dust, tremendous amount of fires on the planet contributing to the dust, volcanic eruptions, earthquakes, possible pole shift, tremendous amount of meteorites, space rock coming in, impacting the Earth, potential tsunamis from that. I mean, just a complete catastrophic scenario. The sun knocking out the electrical grids and knocking out the satellites and snarling up everything on the planet. That's a catastrophic scenario. And the third one is the Earth in lockdown mode from panic, where there is some troubles from the sun and from the debris field of the comet, enough for people to think this is the end of the world and lose their capacity to function in a civil manner, which leads to justification for severe lockdown of the planet and severe changes and a big shift to a centralized global bureaucracy just to deal with all the problems so-called in the world, and people sort of surrender their power to a centralized bureaucracy. So that's how I see the three potential issues going forward here. One, two, and three. So is it, behind door number one? Is it behind door number two? Or is it behind door number three? Let's make a deal. Choose your door, So we can use these symbols here. The smiley face, all is well, the ringed by a dust cloud, as it were, and the prison bars for number three, the three scenarios. Is it one, two, or three? Now, it is true that a lot of the warnings have come from extraterrestrials about what is to come. It's also true that these ETs, some of them, are self-professed liars. They actually say that they tell white lies in order to alter events and psyche, etc., to really reach their agenda on this planet. Now, their agenda is to take over this planet, which they've basically already done, but they need to mop up the situation. There's still, you know, resistance. They've won the battle, but there's still a lot of the countryside is still not under their control, so to speak. So they want a way to gain, you know, easy control over the whole planet. Easy. They like doing things the easy way. So it may be that all these severe warnings about this comet, and, you know, is to get us so sensitized that if we start seeing all these fireballs coming in and hitting impacts and stuff, we start saying, you know, this is it, this is the end of the world. And we simply completely lose our capability to function in a rational, organized way, and then the resistance becomes disorganized. And it's very easy to institute martial law, detainment centers, and et cetera, et cetera. And the blueprint is all there for that to happen. So they may have been lying all this time. They may have been telling lies. Because I know that they certainly are liars. There's no question about it. They take pride in what skilled liars they are. So number three is a possibility. It is a possibility, okay? Number two is also a possibility, because in the past history, there have been catastrophic situations triggered by comets, because comets can tow in or push in a lot of space rock, and they also can destabilize the sun. And the Earth has been impacted catastrophically throughout history in various ways, actually. Extinction of the dinosaurs is one of those in particular. So, and then one first option of nothing happens is also, would be very nice, actually. We hope for number one. I wonder if this 33 thing is pointing out as option three. I don't know. I opened my channel, the YouTube channel, this morning, and the new video that I'm highlighting, I look at the number of views. What do you think the number of views? 33. Of course. 33. I said, oh, you got to be kidding me. So it is worth, I know it stretches, maybe people say, I just want to know what's going to happen, but it's worth understanding the parameters of the situation. It could be one, it could be two, it could be three. And so at least now we might have a better search engine in our own psyche to start to focus intuitively on, well, is it one, two, or three? You know, that, because really either just a smooth pass by, nothing happens, okay, that's definitely, or it could be a minimal kind of stuff, enough stuff to get our attention, and since we've been pre-sensitized, it may trigger panic, or it could be very heavy. Those are pretty minimal. Nothing, light to moderate, or heavy, let's just say, that kind of thing. So we're not locked in, you know, we want to keep our minds free, light, expansive, think outside the box, etc. And then there are various options for our response to the situation, too. So, for instance, let's say number one, nothing happens. Well, we can just continue on as before. Another smiley face or, you know, frowny face, but we're still just here carrying on, you know, as usual. Number two, let's say it's a catastrophic event. Well, certainly we could relocate. We could relocate either to another planet, another, you know, star system, another dimension. There's various possibilities of that. And if it's, for instance, if it's just a kind of a New World Order lockdown thing, well, some people will try and relocate on this planet, move to different places, try to avoid the crackdown, etc. Okay, so those are three options that could certainly take place. Now, hopefully it's option one. And if it is option one, we don't have to worry about it, right? No, not at all. So option one, we don't need to worry about this. Now if it's option three, prison planet, certain there are some people who are survivalists and you know will, are ready for that. Personally, I am not at all. I could not handle such a situation. So for me, if that's what it is, I would still look to option two and relocation. I would not look to try and relocate, you know, somewhere on this planet and try and tough it out, etc. So not too interested in that option. So option three, if we're going to talk about something, it's like what can we do? I would say the third option of some type of relocation is the one that needs to be explored for most people. I mean, there's some, like I said, some people are survivalists, but good luck with that, because if the New World Order really does seize complete control and has the pretext to act unencumbered, unopposed, it's going to be a very nasty situation. So I would, what we're doing is we're trying to say, let's just explore the options on this relocation issue. Actually, this relocation is a very great, is very great for both option one, two, and three, because this world is not a happy place, even if status quo just continues on, is it? And certainly if it's a catastrophic number two, it's not a viable place at all. And if it's number three, this world would be very, very miserable place for a lot of people. So it's really a viable option for both options one, two, and three. A great response to all of those. Now there's no question that the Bible talks about the option of relocation. What the Bible says very clearly is that Jesus is going to come back at the end of this cycle and relocate those who have prepared to do so, plain and simple. There's no two ways about it. He said he's going to go prepare a place for us. He was asked, where are you going? His apostle says, where are you going? Going to prepare a place for you. At the end of the age, I'm going to return and take you to dwell with me in the place I prepared for you. So very unambiguous there in the Bible. So that is asset we have to look at the situation. There's some evidence that the relocation may be indeed possible. May be indeed possible. The question we all have is how? How in the world is this possible? Now Jesus also said, don't worry about that, because the way to do it, you will know. Interesting, the helicopter just flew over at that moment. Maybe, you know, what do helicopters do? They do evacuations, right? How do we evacuate people from, for instance, Vietnam? How we evacuated people through helicopters. Helicopters took them up to a aircraft carrier, or you know, carriers on, and or to Air Force bases or something. So Jesus said, "Don't worry about the way. How is this possible? When the time comes, you will know the way." That's what we're told. Now there's a doctrine in Christianity talks about a rapture, that people will be somehow lifted up from the ground in some kind of, you know, tractor beams or something, like we see like in Star Trek, that literally are able to lift people right off of the planet and into some sort of transport craft, and then presumably from there the shuttlecraft will take them to a larger transport craft, which will then take them to another star system. Or the rapture could be, we're told that the bodies will be transformed into light bodies, bodies of light, and these light bodies will then be able to dwell in another dimension. So that's another possibility. Now I'm sure people wonder, you know, how could we possibly go to another star system? The distance and then the atmosphere, how could, well, I mean, this atmosphere here can certainly be tested, and the balance of gases, etc. It's you know, not too difficult to determine. There could be other places, planets throughout the cosmos that have very similar atmosphere. Could be tweaked. They could tweak the atmosphere to, so it, the body could breathe the atmosphere properly, and then the gravity could be, you know, similar size planet. I mean, it's not too big of a stretch that other dwelling places are suitable for us. In fact, Jesus said that before he left. He said, "In my Father's mansion there are many rooms." In other words, many, many dwelling places. He said, if it were not so, I would have told you. So, most likely there are many, many dwelling places, actually, that have an atmosphere like Earth, and that have a gravity like Earth, and that have a frequency like Earth, and so it would not be, you know, it would not be problematical adjusting to such a place at all. Now, of course, if your body is transformed into a light body, then that's a whole different ballgame right there. As far as distances go, well, we know, most people on this planet know that we have been visited by extraterrestrials throughout history. So they got here. I mean, obviously there are ways to defeat the, you know, space-time continuum as far as how long does it take to travel. Hyperspace, some way of wormholes, stargates, all this kind of stuff. There are ways to do it. That's really not a big issue. So we're trying to boil these issues down so we realize it's really not that big of a deal what we're facing coming up. They'll take the mysticism out of it, take the fear out of it. You know, we just see in our options, maybe nothing will happen. And also it's worth mentioning that we could potentially, there could be some dwelling underground that is also potential. It's been said that there have been cities hollowed out underground for the elite, for the lead of the new cycle after the so-called catastrophes happen. And there could be actually a great amount of underground dwelling places on this planet, as a matter of fact, as well as on other planets. Keep in mind that, from what I understand, much of the dwelling places throughout the cosmos is actually underground. Underground in planets, that some planets are hollow, some planets have massive hollow spaces, etc., and they are able to tap the energy from the core of the planet, etc., to provide them with unlimited amounts of energy, like free energy, don't have to depend on fossil fuels, and they're able to use lighting and simulate sunlight and everything. So just because we see a planet that there's no sign of life on the surface doesn't mean that there isn't a tremendous amount of life, you know, beneath the surface. So it's possible we could relocate to such a place. These are all just variables to look at. But when we become familiar and comfortable with the variables, then our minds don't have to work so hard at the whole situation. And we can focus on what's even more important, which is accepting the Holy Spirit's resolution of the continuity problem, which enables us to not overcome the fear of setting perception down. Because this whole vast situation of existence is a training program attempting to train spirit how to die. And we can't die, so it's just really much ado about nothing. But how do we stop imagining all this? How do we tell mind, I don't need you to imagine this training program for me anymore. How do we do that? Because we're so addicted to it, we're afraid if we don't have it, we can't function at all. There's no way of functioning. We believe perception is reality. That what we're seeing, perceiving is reality. It's not. It's not. It's a hallucination. Perception is hallucination, actually. And reality cannot be perceived. It's only known. So we can't see reality. We can only know reality. We can see something that reminds us of reality, but that's as close as we can possibly get, and that's what the Holy Spirit provides us, is a new perception and a new means of perception. So that's the ultimate goal. the situation here with the end of one cycle, the overlapping of two cycles, and the comet's coming in. We have three possible scenarios, and we have, you know, three different ways we can react to it. All of that is it's part of the mix, but it's not the central part of it. It's sort of like a three-ring circus we got going right now. The real issue is, again, repentance, meaning accepting the fact that we do have this enormous continuity problem, and two, that we can't solve it. We cannot solve it because we were not created to solve a continuity problem. We're not able to. The Holy Spirit was created specifically by God to solve the continuity problem that we have, that Spirit has. So repent means I'm there's a problem that I cannot solve from my own efforts. And then accept the Holy Spirit's resolution, the means of resolving the continuity problem, which is this new perception. That is the central issue always, always. This other stuff, they're sideshows. But it does impact our situation because it impacts our attention and our focus, our determination. It does have a strong impact in that way. It can delay the situation or it can accelerate it. Both. So knowing about this ahead of time has accelerated my efforts. And here we come with a helicopter again. Right overhead. Very unusual. So, and yet if we're not prepared for it and this stuff hits us unawares, definitely we're going to have our attention just, you know, thrown all over the place. It's just not a good thing. So I would say that when you know that there's some trouble coming, you can use it to say, well, I really have to focus in and get the job done before this trouble happens. Like, you know, there's a storm coming, a hurricane. You go down, you know, to Home Depot, get the plywood and board up your windows. And when you get it done before the hurricane hits, you say, you know what? I did a great job. I'm protected. Now, let's say there's other people who say, hurricane, I'm not too worried about this one. You know, they always scare us like that. I'm kind of tired. I don't want to deal with it. Maybe they don't have the money, too, it's possible. But whatever reason, they don't get the job done in time. And then when the hurricane hits, it's blowing out the windows. Stuff's flying through their house, you know, and it's a disaster. Things just get ruined. And of course, their mind is completely scattered. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, look what's happening. Whereas it's all boarded up, all taken care of. You know, you could even sit there in the hurricane, you know, doing meditation and contemplation and say, I don't even have to really, you know, focus on, not worried about it at all. So you see, that's the difference of preparing ahead of time. The Bible, Jesus in the Bible, it emphasizes over and over and over again, be prepared ahead of time. The parables, all the parables say, look, be trustworthy and prepare and be ready and be alert for the time that is to come. Don't be caught, you know, don't go out and squander your time, your money, and your focus and your attention and all that. Keep your attention on the prize and be prepared for those times that will come like a thief in the night. Now, a comet certainly comes like a thief in the night, doesn't it? Triggering the instability of the sun, you know, severe space weather impacting the earth, that comes like a thief in the night. See, these are not things, cosmic things are like a thief in the night. If you know, these days that we have all this technology, we're able to say, oh, here comes a comet. But, you know, in the past, no. You know, just one day, you know, it shows up. So, oh, wow. You know, there it is. Uh-oh. At least this time we had some warnings, and especially from those intuitives like myself who've been giving out warnings for a long, long time. My whole life I've been saying, you better use this time, this 33-year grace period, to prepare. I mean, starting in late 1979, I really Well, actually, starting in 78. And then by the time 79 came around, I was completely in full-on emergency mode to, you know, just like boarding up the windows, you know, frantically, you know, working to prepare. And spent the entire 33 years doing that, the entirety of it. And I told other people, you got to do that too, you know. Don't just go along with the crowd. Like, everything is going to be fine, no worries. Because when trouble hits, you're not ready. And then your mind becomes frantic, and then you cannot, you miss your opportunity. So I've done my preparations, and I'm still continuing on, you know. Today I woke up at 4:30 in the morning, and spent about 8 hours of intense focus, working as hard as I possibly could on trying to accept the ego's offer and get free of this dreaded egoic flesh death-based training program that tries to stick to you like glue. It's got stick'em on it, and it's so difficult. 8 hours, and now I've been taping. I did a lot of taping that wasn't, you know, didn't seem quite right, maybe an hour and a half or so, but then this one. So I've just been relentlessly continuing to prepare, and trying to help others prepare too. That's part of the thing. If you're ready ahead of time, you can help others prepare. So that's a side benefit. But certainly, I can hardly remember the 80s or the 90s, to tell you the truth, because I was so intensely absorbed in preparation. It was just, I really was not aware of too much that was going on in the world. And I was told, look, doesn't matter, don't worry about it. It's really nothing. It's not worth even focusing on, which is true, which is really true. Because once you know what the big issues are, you realize that's what's important. This other stuff is just little sideshows on the midway, you know, of these little booths. You go to the circus or a fair or something, there's all these little booths where you throw dimes and quarters on glass plates and things. You know, you want to see the big top, you know, with the elephants coming in and then the acrobats and all of the, you know, the big show and the big tent. You want to get into the big tent. So don't waste your time on this sideshow stuff. Get into the big tent where the big ideas are. So I will keep some videos coming, whatever I think is helpful and useful here. And hopefully we can keep relaxing, diminishing the panic, increasing our focus on what we really need. And the best thing, the ultimate thing, is to be able to keep your attention on the Holy Spirit, on repentance. Keep your attention on repentance, the resolution of the continuity problem. Keep your attention on that. And in that way, no matter what happens, you know, you are keeping your eye on the prize, the real prize, the big prize. That is for sure, because actually, everything that is happening in existence has really nothing to do with us whatsoever. It doesn't even touch us. It doesn't even touch us. All of these problems and upset and sickness and dying, etc., is not happening to us at all. It's the play of the flesh. Play of the flesh, trying to see what can never be, trying to know what can never be known, which is death. It sees death everywhere, but it doesn't know death, because death isn't real, and only the real is known, and there's nothing but the real. Okay, so really, this dance of the flesh is much ado about nothing. Death can never be known. Impermanence can never be known. It cannot be known. What we are is known. The dance of this phantasmagoric dance of impermanence can never be known. It can only be perceived, but not known. So what we want to do is to perceive a different dance, or to perceive an overlay of the dance, something that is unchanged, something that is not dying. And we want to perceive that, and that will remind us of reality. So we want to continue to be able to look at this, and I call it the overlay. You call it the overlay. A vision of that which is untouched by the dance of the flesh, and yet we're still perceiving it. It is still something that is perceptible, in some, maybe in a subtle way, spiritual perception, as it were. And this will then enable us, remind us of reality, like, ah, something untouched by anything, right? Unchanged. And yet, at some point, we set down the perception for the knowing. And in knowing, there's no possibility of perception. There's no possibility it could ever be otherwise. Whereas in perception, there's always the possibility that perception can be altered, right? There's always that that possibility. And so let's keep our eye on the prize, and at the same time not be stupid and uninformed about the options that could arise. And going forward, these are the options. We have three options. I mean, nothing happens, it's catastrophic, or it's a panic operation to bring about the new world order. Okay, so we simply need to be very wise and very smart, and yet then keep our eye on the prize. Okay, well, that's it for this one right now.